Let's begin.
Hello everyone, I'm Lokesh. I have with me Siddhant.
Hey everyone,
So
great to be here.
today we'll be discussing about balancing problem in ozone and the corresponding situation which ozone has today. A little background about us. I'm senior software engineer in Cloudera. I have been contributing to Apache Ozone, Apache Rattus, and Apache Hadoop for past 4+ years. Currently, I hold PMC and committer privileges for all these projects.
Hey, this is Siddhant. I'm also an engineer at Cloudera. I recently graduated from college just a few months ago. And this is my first year of contributing to Apache and my first ever ApacheCon. So I'm excited to be here and share our work on Ozone with you all. Go ahead, Lokesh.
So we'll be first sharing a basic introduction about Ozone and then an overview of architecture. And later on, we'll be discussing the balancing problem and the corresponding solution. So Ozone is a distributed object store. The namespace comprises of volumes, buckets, and keys. The namespace can be accessed using the object store, file system, and S3 API. Ozone started off as a sub-project in Hadoop, but currently it is a top-level project in Apache. So let's take a brief overview of the architecture. So data nodes are the storage nodes, and these are the physical hosts which actually store the block data. They also manage all the disks inside the host and other logic related to container creation, etc. So periodically, data nodes would send container reports to SCM. So container is a layer of abstraction in Ozone. Every container is of by default of size 5 GB, and it has a collection of blocks. So periodically, data nodes would be sending these container reports to SCM. And SCM is making sure that all the containers are sufficiently replicated in the system. In case SCM finds a container is under-replicated, it will schedule a replication for that container. And if it finds that a container is over-replicated, it will schedule a deletion for excess replica. Further, SCM maintains a container map, which maps the container ID to set of data nodes, which contain the corresponding replica for the container. So container abstraction is different from HDFS in Ozone. In HDFS, data nodes are sending block reports. So through the container abstraction, the number of entities which a data node has to manage reduces by a factor of 100. Similarly, SCM also has to maintain a small overhead in terms of the container map. So SCM and data nodes, they together form the Hadoop distributed data storage layer. And this is the data layer in Ozone. And the metadata, that is the namespace layer, is different. So Ozone has Ozone Manager, which manages the namespace. The Ozone Manager would maintain a mapping from file to set of blocks. So every block is combination of every block ID is a combination of container ID and local ID. Container ID identifies the container, and local ID is specific to that container. Ozone Manager keeps only a working set in RAM. So this is again a very different from HDFS name node. In HDFS, the name node keeps the entire namespace in memory. And that is why HDFS more than 300 million files, the HDFS name node can see a lot of GC pressures. Further, Ozone also has a recon server. The recon server is a background service which can be accessed by the admin to identify any corruption in files or missing containers. Ozone provides a very clean separation of block or container layer. So the namespace layer is very different from the block layer in Ozone. Further, Ozone has been designed to coexist with HDFS in a cluster. So Ozone data nodes can run on the same physical host as HDFS data nodes. And the design is such that the Ozone operations do not interfere with HDFS operations. Let's look at the namespace layer in a more detailed manner. So as we discussed, the namespace comprises of volumes, buckets, and keys. Volumes are like user or admin accounts in Azure. Buckets and keys are similar to what S3 provides today. Ozone is a strongly consistent system. All the metadata or data updates in Ozone happen via RAS consensus protocol. Further, the users can access Ozone using two APIs, Hadoop File System API and S3 API. So most of the big data applications can access Ozone using the Hadoop compatible file system API. And the other non-big data apps can access Ozone using the S3 gateway. Now let's look at the storage layer. As we discussed, the storage layer comprises of SCM, data nodes, and containers. Container is a unit of replication in Ozone. A container is by default of 5 GB size. It is a set of blocks. All the data writes, block writes in a container happen through RAS consensus protocol. Every container has a unique container ID. This is a global ID for the container. And then every block inside the container is represented by a block ID, which is a combination of container ID and local ID. Local ID is specific to the container. Then we have data nodes. Data nodes, as we discussed, are the storage nodes. They store these containers, and periodically they send container reports to SCM. SCM is a more of a cluster manager. It receives these container reports from data nodes, and it makes sure that all the containers are sufficiently replicated in Ozone. Now let's look at the structure of a storage container. The container comprises of RocksDB instance and the data file. The RocksDB instance stores the metadata related to the block or the container. Every block has a corresponding key in RocksDB, which maps to a set of files where that block data is present. Further, RocksDB also maintains other container metadata related to deletion. Then the container also comprises of chunk files or data files. These files store the actual block data. Now Siddhant will discuss the balancing problem and the corresponding solution.
All right, thanks, Rakesh. Next slide. Yeah. So the motivation behind container balancing is an unbalanced cluster. An unbalanced cluster basically is a cluster which has some data nodes that have too much data and other data nodes that have too less data in comparison. Such a situation could arise because of various reasons. One reason is when new data nodes are added to the cluster. Another reason is when data is deleted from the cluster, leading to some data nodes having far more available space than other ones. In this situation, some nodes are overutilized and other nodes end up being underutilized. And this is an unbalanced cluster. Let's look at an example of an unbalanced cluster next and try to find out why it's really a problem. Okay, so we have a cluster here with 6 data nodes running on full capacity. So the big rectangles there are data nodes, and the smaller rectangles inside them are containers. If you look at the legend below the line, the red rectangles denote overutilized data nodes. Yellow rectangle denotes a data node with average utilization, while the small rectangles in blue are closed containers. Closed containers are immutable. Okay, so we have a cluster with 6 data nodes and it's pretty heavily loaded. As you can see, three of our data nodes are red overutilized nodes. But we want to add more data to this. So what do we do? Next slide. We introduce new data nodes. So these three fresh green data nodes don't have any data inside them, while the rest of the cluster has a lot of data. Like, as you can see right now, some of our older nodes, the red ones are overutilized, while the new ones, they don't have any data inside them, they're underutilized. Now, this is an unbalanced cluster with overutilized and underutilized nodes. And it's a problem because, first of all of our read requests would still be going to the old data nodes because that's where the data is at. This means reduced read parallelism. And also, in case Ozone now decides to start writing new containers to the new data nodes, the green ones, we would have reduced write parallelism because the write requests are solely going to those three new nodes. So, well, although we managed to increase the capacity of the cluster, this isn't really helping our situation, and it's a problem. Let's think of a solution for this. Okay, thinking about it, a straightforward solution that occurs to me is that we can move some data or some containers from the overutilized red nodes to the underutilized green nodes. And that is, in fact, a solution on the next slide. Next slide, please. All right, so our solution has three steps here. The first step is to calculate the utilization of each data node. Yeah, so now we've been talking about the term utilization intuitively for a while now. Let's actually define it on the next slide. Next slide, yeah. Okay, the utilization of a data node is its use space divided by its capacity. For a cluster, the utilization is the total use space of all the data nodes divided by the total capacity of all the data nodes. We can't simply compare two data nodes in terms of the use space because different data nodes might have different capacities. So there we need a ratio of use space to capacity, and that is what utilization is. Next slide. All right, how do we calculate utilization? First, we need the capacity, and we can obtain that by using the get total space method in the Java IO file package. The second thing is we need the use space. Now, for getting the use space, we have two methods again. The first accurate but slow method is to use the Linux du command. The du command steps through each Ozone directory and goes on calculating the use space in each of them. The second approximate but fast way is to first get the free space in the partition and then subtract it from the capacity. Now, both of these ways could be used depending on the situation, and we can specify which one we want in the Ozone configuration file. Okay, next slide. All right, now we've calculated the capacity of each data node, and now we need to find out if the cluster is unbalanced. To find that out, first of all, we need to define balance and threshold. Next slide. Okay, the threshold is a user-defined fraction in the range of 0 to 1. Now we use this term threshold to talk about balance. A cluster is balanced if the utilization of each data node differs from the cluster utilization by no more than the threshold. To explain what this means, to understand this, I have a picture on the next slide. Okay, so to understand that definition, I have two data nodes here. Let's first talk about the data node, the red one on your left. The red bar in that data node denotes its utilization, While the solid line running through its center is the cluster utilization. So the red bar is the data nodes utilization, while the solid line in the center is the cluster's utilization. Okay, this data node is overutilized. Why? Because its utilization is above the dotted line, the dashed line there, which is cluster utilization plus threshold. Conversely, the other data node is underutilized because its utilization is below the cluster utilization minus our threshold value. This tells us that using our threshold, we can define what balance means. All the data nodes that have utilization outside of that zone that's marked by cluster utilization plus minus threshold would be either overutilized or underutilized. Okay, next slide. All right, now we know that our cluster is unbalanced. We can balance it by moving containers from the overutilized nodes to the underutilized nodes. Okay, so those are the three steps of the solution, and they are wrapped up and packaged as the container balancer, which Lokesh will talk about now.
Thanks, Sudhan. So container balancer is a service in SCM. SCM, as we discussed, is the cluster manager. It is receiving the data node report. And so how does a container balancer operate today? Container balancer would do balancing in multiple iterations. There is a wait period between every iteration. So in every iteration, it is trying to move some data. And with every iteration, the balancer would transition the cluster from unbalanced to more balanced state. So let's look at what an iteration looks like today. In a typical iteration, the balancer would first identify over and underutilized data node. This is using the same formula which Sidhan discussed. So once balancer has identified the over and underutilized data node, it will identify source and target data nodes based on selection criteria. So for every overutilized data node, it will try to find a pair of container and target data node, so that the container can be moved from the overutilized data node to the target data node. So this selection criteria will be discussed in the next slide. So once a balancer has determined these move requests, it will issue these move requests to replication manager. In a typical move request, the balancer would be specifying the container ID. This is the container which should be moved from the source data node to the target data node. And in return, replication manager returns the completable future. So this future can be queried by a balancer in order to identify the state of the move. So replication manager is the component in SCM which makes sure that all the containers are sufficiently replicated. So it handles the under replication and over replication of containers as discussed previously. For the move, replication manager would replicate the container to the target data node. And once the replication is successful, it will issue a delete container in the source data node. Once both of these steps complete successfully, it will complete the future. So now let's look at the selection criteria. So a typical selection criteria is that container after move should still obey the placement policy. So a placement policy can be something like every container replica should be in a different rack. And balancer needs to make sure that the new target data node for a container obeys the placement policy. Then the target should not already have that container replica. This is one basic requirement. The target should be a healthy data node. It should not be a data node which is decommissioned or under maintenance. And then user can provide its own list of data nodes in the selection criteria. Further, replication manager needs to make sure that priority of replication is greater than priority of move request coming from balancer. So Similarly, we have a selection criteria for the container. The container should not be under or over replicated. Then the container should be immutable. That is, balancer always moves closed containers. So closed containers have a consistent state in SCM, and balancer does not move open containers. Then containers should not already have been selected. This is one of the basic requirements. And then balancer should always move larger containers if possible. And further, user can also provide its own exclude and include list. So some of the design principles for balancer. Balancer is a stateless service. So balancer does not maintain any state related to data node, container, or replicas. Every iteration, it will identify the over and under utilized data node and then schedule some move requests. So that's how it does not maintain any state in the service. Further, balancer uses interface-driven design. So it uses an interface or APIs which are supported by other SCM components like node manager, container manager. So it uses these APIs to fetch data node utilization info or container and replica information. So new interfaces were also added for balancer to identify the target container, target data node, and the container which needs to be moved to these target data nodes. Further, another API is added to support the container move in replication manager. The idea of balancer can also be extended to balance hot and cold data in the cluster. So it only needs a hotness or coolness metric in the cluster. So in case data nodes have more containers which are more frequently accessed, those containers can be efficiently balanced in the entire cluster. So this would help in some of the read parallelism. So now Siddhant will take you through some of the algorithm in detail.
Thanks. Yes, now let's step through the algorithm and try to visualize it. So this is where we were. We had a cluster at full capacity with 6 data nodes. And next slide. And we added new data nodes to it to increase its capacity. But now we have a cluster with overutilized and underutilized data nodes, and it's unbalanced. We already know it's a problem, but thankfully now we have the container balancer to help us out. So let's start the container balancer service and go to the next slide. All right, so just to recall, this is the solution that had 3 steps. First of all, balancer needs to calculate the utilization of each healthy data node. Next, once it's done that, it needs to find out if the cluster is unbalanced. And finally, if it is unbalanced, we need to balance it by moving the containers from overutilized to underutilized data nodes. Okay, next slide. All right, so I have a diagram of the SCM here with the container balancer running inside it as a service and our data nodes. All this while, these data nodes have been sending storage reports to the SCM along with the heartbeat. The balancer can now process these storage reports to calculate the utilization of each data node, as we discussed. That was step 1. And after calculating the utilization, it can determine the overutilized and the underutilized nodes. There's a notable difference here from HDFS. The HDFS balancer tool was a separate service, while here in Ozone, the container balancer is a service inside the SCM, which means it can make use of these storage reports that are already available with the SCM. Instead of explicitly asking the data nodes for full storage reports. This can help us in preventing a lot of traffic that was often observed when the balancer would run in HDFS. Okay, next slide. So by processing the storage reports, balancer has been able to identify the red overutilized nodes and the green underutilized nodes. Now it can begin iterating, and by using the selection criteria that Lokesh talked about, it's going to select target and source and target data nodes which are overutilized and underutilized. And as you just saw, using again the selection criteria, it would move containers from the source to the target. So this is what an iteration looks like, moving containers from source to targets. And after a few iterations of doing this, on the next slide, you'll see that, yeah, you can see that balancer is, it has made the cluster more balanced now. All of our data nodes have approximately average utilization. Next slide. And a more balanced cluster is a great thing, because now our read-write requests can go to multiple data nodes all over the cluster, which means increased parallelism. Also, our new data nodes are actually helping by reducing load on the existing ones. Okay, next slide. Now let's talk about limits and throttling in container balancer. Our aim here is to limit the maximum size of data and the maximum number of data nodes that will be involved in balancing in each iteration. To serve that purpose, we have a few limits. The first limit there is the maximum size that can be moved from or to a data node. Second, we have a limit on the maximum size that can be moved in total between, like, among all the data nodes in an iteration by the balancer. Third, we can specify the percentage of total data nodes that we want to be involved in balancing. And finally, we have a limit on the network bandwidth that will be used for container move operations. These limits, they help us in avoiding all the replication storms and causing a huge amount of traffic in Ozone. But also, they help us in giving an estimate of the performance. So we know how much data needs to be balanced, right? And we have the second limit there that tells us the maximum size that can be moved by balancer in one iteration. So if you divide the size of data that needs to be balanced by the maximum size that can be balanced in one iteration, we get the number of iterations that, the minimum number of iterations that balancer will need to balance that data. Now, if we multiply this count by the time an iteration takes, we'll get a minimum time that balancer will need to add to balance this data in the cluster. Okay, next slide. All right, and that's it. These are our email addresses. If you have any questions, we'll be happy to take them. And thank you. See you in the next session, Lokesh.
Yeah.
Best of luck.
Thank you, everyone, for attending. I also have another talk regarding the Ozone performance. So if you have time, please attend that. I see some questions here. Yeah, so rack utilization. Okay, so we have a concept for balancer in terms of data nodes, that is we identify if data nodes are under or overutilized, but we don't have right now a concept of rack utilization. But I think balancers would be useful even in those cases, right? So in case a rack is underutilized, then the data nodes would be underutilized in that rack, and ultimately the balancer can be used for moving some of that data to the other rack. So then we have a question that, does Ozone provide an API by which we can get the data node utilization and cluster utilization? Yes, we do have an, so we have a command line utility. Siddhant, do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, sure. So we have a command line utility that's called the data node usage info tool. And it can give us an, for a specific data node, it can give us an idea of, it can tell us its use space capacity and remaining space values. And it also has options for getting a list of data nodes sorted according to their utilizations in descending or ascending order. So for specific to a data node, we can get a data node's utilization, and for the entire cluster, we can get a list of the healthy in-service nodes sorted according to the utilization values. In the background, again, this API uses the DU or the DF commands as specified in the configurations.
So do we have any other questions related to balancer? I guess we can close the session then.
All right.
Yeah. Thanks everyone.
Thanks everyone for having us. Thank you.